Today we begin book two. And as we go through these first two chapters of the book, you should expect to be challenged, and you should expect to reflect on what assumptions you may have built up in your mind about what Christianity is. Lewis's goal is to clear the air, to begin from the ground up about what Christianity believes. He wants to correct any misconceptions that may have crept into our minds about Christianity before we move forward. The purpose of this is twofold. First, I'll refer to another Christian author and apologist who makes this important point. He says, "I have rarely come across someone that actually disagrees with Christian thought. Rather, I come across many people who disagree with false versions of Christian thought that have become popularized." The author means this. Often people come up with their own versions of Christianity, either by their own personal thoughts or because other mainstream views of the day seem to creep into their understanding. First of all, Lewis wants to clear the air so that these falsities aren't included in mere Christianity. His goal is that this will better help someone who is not Christian understand true Christianity, possibly for the very first time. Second, for us who are Christians, this should help us reflect on any of our own assumptions that we may have mistaken for Christian thought. If we believe that we are by our very nature sinful, and if we believe that the devil is always out there to deceive us, we should logically always be aware that even our own minds can sometimes try and lead us astray. This is why returning to God's word and returning to the teachings of the church help combat those false assumptions coming into our Christian thought. Lewis is trying to help us with this, which is why his book is about mere Christianity. He is sticking with the core Christian teachings of the church, ones that should root us firmly in our united Christian faith. As Lewis begins telling us what Christians believe, he sets the stage with an important difference between Christianity and atheism, pointing out that Christians do not have to believe that other religions of the world are 100% completely wrong. This is different from atheism, because atheists have to believe that the core belief of all religions, belief in the divine, is at its core completely wrong. Thus, his point is that an atheist really has to believe that the large majority of the world and history are looking at reality in an utterly erroneous way, and that they are the few that see the truth that everyone else seems to have been missing. That said, it is, of course, essential that Christianity also recognizes where their religion differs from other religions. And of course, that when this happens, that they believe that Christianity is right and the other worldview is wrong. As Lewis says, there is only one right answer to a sum in arithmetic, and all other answers are wrong. The key is that although there is one right answer, and only one, some answers may be closer to the right answer than others. So the first takeaway, as Lewis sets the stage for how we understand the rival conceptions or other viewpoints that people hold about God, is to understand that the atheist, or the materialist as we called him in our last lesson, thinks that every religion which believes in God is wrong at the outset. They are the ones who stand the most opposed to most societies and religions in history. Second, that even though all religions have much more similarities with each other than they do with atheism, they are still all different. And just as with arithmetic, there is only one right answer, it is the job of the person, of you and of me, to examine these different religious claims about God and explore which one is in fact the right one. Next, Lewis begins by exploring the first big division of beliefs about God. You can imagine a group of, let's say, 100 people setting off on a journey. Right at the outset, 5 of the 100 decide to turn around and go in a completely different direction than everyone else. That would be the atheists or the materialists, who do not believe in any God or deity or spirit outside of what we see in the material world. Next, we have the 95 people, all believing that there is something else out there which has brought this world into being. Now we are arriving at the first real fork in the road of the journey for these 95 people. This fork is the difference between those who think that God is part of the universe and those who think that God is outside of the universe. The first view is held by many Eastern religions, such as Hinduism, The second is held by Western religions such as Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. So let's unpack the difference. The Eastern view, we can call this pantheism, believes that creation and God are one. Therefore, everything in creation is actually a part of God. The material world and what you would call the spirit or God are intertwined. A rock is a part of God, a river, the clouds. This means that God is not someone who creates something separate from himself, but that God is the most powerful thing within the material universe. The most tangible result of this, for our purposes, is that this Eastern view thinks that all things are part of God. This means that the good and the bad, the beautiful and the seemingly ugly, are all equally part of God. This is why places like in India has historically, before Christianity came into the country, had a caste system. This is because poverty and suffering are just as much part of God's system as wealth and happiness. They refuse to call one good and worthy and the other one bad and worth helping because their religious belief told them that God intended for all of this because he is, of course, part of all of this. This is the first path for the first fork in the road. Half of the remaining 95 have gone that way, but the other half go the other way. And this is the common Western view. It's the view held by Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Mormonism, etc., etc. This view is the one we are familiar with, and it holds God to be like a painter or an architect. A painter creates a picture, but he's not part of the picture. He's not paint or canvas, but something that stands outside and uses the paint and canvas to create something beautiful. Now, of course, we would say he is going to put a lot of his own thoughts and beautiful expressions into this painting. We would say that in a painting, you will see the mind and the expression of the artist. But of course, this is different than thinking the artist is part of the creation. This is the view that Christians hold. And of course, when we get to the incarnation later on, we will have another discussion on this. But for now, it suffices to say that the Christian idea of God, among other religions, is fundamentally different than the pantheist view of God, and it leads to a completely different way of life. The most pointed of these will again be the understanding of good and evil. The pantheist struggles to articulate good and bad, but the religious man who thinks of God as outside of creation can see God as supporting some things and opposing others. This is because he is not part of creation, but stands outside of it. He is an artist, and something has come in and distorted parts of his work. This is what is considered bad or sinful. God calls it bad, and he stands opposed to it. That's why we, of course, understand it as bad. And then he supports that which is good, that which coincides with his intention, which is, of course, why we call it good. This is why the Christian says, our job is to help put the wrongs right. That is what we have been called to do, to fight for good and fight against bad. As Lewis says in this chapter, for Christianity is a fighting religion. It thinks that God made the world, but also thinks that a great many things have gone wrong and that God insists very loudly on putting them right again. So, we have now seen two forks in the road. And Lewis disagrees, as he's shown, with first atheism, because it's too simple, and in the end it denies true right and wrong. He also disagrees with pantheism, or common Eastern religions, because they also deny true right and wrong by saying both right and wrong are equally part of God. Yin and yang, if you've ever seen the symbol. So now, we are left with about half of the people that we started out with in the beginning. Now, there's no way in pretending that these differences are just minor things. As Lewis points out, these forks in the road lead to completely different understandings of right and wrong, and views of the world, God, us, the meaning of life, the list goes on. Now, he is going to deal with something less like a fork in the road, and more like a side path that is mislabeled. A wandering path that many take and that leads nowhere good. It's something we as Christians must watch out for. Lewis calls it Christianity and water. Listen to what he says. Very well then, atheism is too simple. And I will tell you another view that is also too simple. It is the view I call Christianity and water. The view which simply says there is a good God in heaven and everything is all right, leaving out all the difficult and terrible doctrines about sin and hell and the devil and the redemption. Both these are boys' philosophies. As Lewis says, it's no good asking for a oversimplified religion, which is what he calls Christianity and water. Because after all, real things are not simple. In fact, as he points out, reality is hardly ever simple. The body isn't, relationships aren't, creation isn't. Reality is complex. And one of the leading reasons he himself came to believe in Christianity was because it's just the kind of religion which you couldn't have made up on your own. It's too complex, with twists and turns all the way through. A simple religion, you could expect that to be invented by man. But the things you find in Christianity, the incarnation, the Trinity, for example, turn out to be complex enough that only God could have come up with it, or maybe revealed it to us, is a better way to put it. So, what's the complex problem and complex answer that we find within Christianity? Well, Lewis puts it this way. The problem is not simple, and the answer is not going to be simple either. What is the problem? A universe that contains much that is obviously bad and apparently meaningless, but containing creatures like ourselves who know that it is bad and meaningless. There are only two views that face all the facts. One is the Christian view, that this is a good world that has gone wrong, but still retains the memory of what it ought to have been. The other is the view called dualism. Dualism means the belief that there are two equal and independent powers at the back of everything, one of them good and the other bad, and that this universe is the battlefield in which they fight out an endless war. I personally think that next to Christianity, dualism is the manliest and most sensible creed on the market. But it has a catch in it. Notice that both of these views acknowledge that there is a true good and evil, which is why they are farther down the path together. They have avoided the early wrong turns in the road. They both acknowledge a universe of beauty that has been marred, and admits that one is good, the beauty, and one bad, the marring. However, dualism, which is going to be the next fork in the road, has a problem. Lewis points out that if both the good and the bad were there at the beginning, then they would both be equal. However, as soon as we call one good and the other bad, we are saying that they aren't equal, that one is actually better than the other. One was the creation and one was the marring. We are saying that there is a higher standard that both would have to submit to. Lewis points out that this standard that we judge things on, and the being who made this standard, would then be higher than both sides. And the being which created the standard would, of course, then be the true God. In simple terms, dualism ends up running into the same issue as the other views that we've looked at. However, we can actually learn something about Christianity from this. Lewis points out that Christianity is actually much like dualism in some very telling ways. For Christianity does believe that there are two opposing sides, good and evil. Christianity does speak of a dark power and an evil spirit behind the dark power. Lewis is, of course, speaking of Satan. Satan is the power behind evil in this world. And there is an opposing power called good, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven. And they are having a battle right here on our planet. And we are involved. But above all of this is God himself, the one who created the world, the one who created even Satan himself before Satan rebelled. Lewis summarizes it this way. The difference is that Christianity thinks this dark power was created by God and was good when he was created and went wrong. Christianity agrees with dualism that this universe is at war, but it does not think this is a war between independent powers. It thinks it is a civil war, a rebellion, and that we are living in a part of the universe occupied by the rebel, enemy-occupied territory. That is what this world is. Christianity is the story of how the rightful king has landed. You might say landed in disguise, and is calling us all to take part in a great campaign of sabotage. When you go to church, you are really listening in to the secret wireless from our friends. That is why the enemy is so anxious to prevent us from going. As Lewis says, Christianity is a fighting religion. It means that we are called to stand as Christian soldiers and to fight against the forces of evil, standing with the forces of good. This is an essential foundation for the Christian understanding, which is why he begins this chapter by saying, watered down Christianity won't do. We cannot omit the serious doctrines about sin and hell and the devil and the redemption. If we do, we miss the true biblical story of the King who has come to earth to lead us on in victory against those evil forces who have infiltrated, sabotaged, and rebelled against God's good creation. Thank you for joining us. Next week, we will look at chapters 3, 4, and 5 of Book 2. And you are also invited to join us for our Zoom Bible study, which takes place tomorrow on Thursday at 2 p.m. Thank you, and God bless.